Biographical Bites from Bala, Laurel Hill West Stories, number 32, for mid-May 2024. Dennis Sandole, the Lodestar of Philadelphia Jazz. Welcome to the 32nd episode of Biographical Bites from Bala, Laurel Hill West Stories, an historic and active cemetery in Bala Cynwyd, Pennsylvania. I am Dr. Joe Lex, retired professor of emergency medicine from Temple University, volunteer tour guide, and volunteer podcaster. Laurel Hill West opened in 1869 across the river from its sister cemetery, Laurel Hill East in Philadelphia. It's more than twice as big as Laurel Hill East. It has a totally different feel and a strikingly different population. And like Laurel Hill East, it is open 365 days a year, from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. right now. There's plenty of parking at the business office just off Belmont Avenue, or at the conservatory and the bell tower. Another possibility, just come in while you're walking the Cynwyd Trail. This 32nd episode of Biographical Bites from Bala is from mid-May 2024. Dennis Sandole, a guitar player and music teacher from South Philadelphia, was sought as a teacher by the top jazz players of his day, including John Coltrane, who used his lessons to develop into both the Sheets of Sound and Coltrane Changes that he is remembered for today. Dennis is interred at the Mausoleum of Peace, slot 241, on the other side of Righters Ferry Road, just a few feet from disc jockey and rap pioneer Jocko Henderson. I think you'll enjoy his story, and I think you'll enjoy some of the music I'm going to play for you today. I have been a huge fan of jazz for as long as I can remember. Believe it or not, top 40 radio in the late 1950s and early 60s would sneak in jazz tunes occasionally. I'm pretty sure the first time I ever heard Dave Brubeck's Take Five, or Ramsey Lewis Trio's The In Crowd, or Vince Guaraldi's Linus and Lucy, it was on WLS, or another of Chicago's pop music stations. I admit that I was a latecomer to saxophonist John Coltrane, but when he finally clicked with me, I was overwhelmed. As I learned more and more about music, I found out that Coltrane had probably been there before me. And trumpeter Miles Davis knew exactly what he had found when Coltrane joined his group in 1955. You probably know the names John Coltrane and Miles Davis, even if you're not sure what they sound like. I can summarize the two of them more or less like this. 1987, Miles Davis reluctantly agreed to attend an awards dinner at the Reagan White House with his current girlfriend, or at least one of his current girlfriends, Cecily Tyson. Now, this was rather uncharacteristic for a man who had always been bluntly honest about himself and about others to even show up for such an occasion. He wrote in his autobiography that he went out of respect for Ray Charles, who was receiving an award that night. Now, according to Davis' account, he was sitting at a table with a woman he described as a politician's wife when she asked him an apparently well-meant question about America's neglect of jazz. "Jazz is ignored here because the white man likes to win everything," Davis responded with his usual asperity. Rattled, the woman asked him, "Well, what have you done that's so important in your life?" Davis didn't pause. "Well," he said, "I've changed music 5 or 6 times." And he wasn't that far from the truth. The transitions in jazz from bebop to cool jazz to hard bop to modal to electronic jazz to jazz funk all run through every aspect of Miles Davis's career. But then there was John Coltrane. He was a different breed entirely, almost scarily so. He listened to everyone and everything, and he tried to incorporate it into his music. Indian, African, modernist classical composers, opera, gospel, flamenco, avant-garde. Coltrane had big ears and bigger ideas. By the end of his tragically short life, he died of liver cancer at age 40 in 1967. He had almost entered another physical and spiritual dimension of being. And no, I am not just making that up. I mean, Miles Davis may have changed the music 5 or 6 times. Coltrane changed people's perceptions of what music should be. When he finally got a Pulitzer Prize 40 years posthumously, it said it was for his, quote, masterful improvisation, supreme musicianship, and iconic centrality to the history of jazz, end quote. He was not in the iconic centrality as yet in the late 1950s and the early 1960s. So how did Coltrane get here? June 1943, shortly after he graduated from high school in North Carolina, Coltrane and his family moved to Philadelphia. He got a job at a sugar refinery. There's evidence that he also worked for Campbell Soup for a while. On his 17th birthday, in September of 1943, his mother bought him his first saxophone, an alto sax. To avoid being drafted by the Army, Coltrane enlisted in the Navy on 6 August 1945, the day the first U.S. atomic bomb was dropped on Japan. He was trained as an apprentice seaman at Sampson Naval Training Station in upstate New York before he was shipped to Pearl Harbor. There he was stationed at Manana Barracks, the largest posting of African-American servicemen in the world. Now, by the time he got to Hawaii in late 1945, the Navy was downsizing. Coltrane's musical talent was recognized. He became one of the few Navy men to serve as a musician without having been granted musician's rating when he joined the Melody Masters, the bass swing band. Because the Melody Masters was an all-white band, Coltrane was treated as a guest performer to avoid alerting superior officers of his participation in the band. Remember, this is before the military services integrated in 1947. Coltrane was officially discharged from the Navy in August 1946. He was awarded the American Campaign Medal, Asiatic Pacific Campaign Medal, and the World War II Victory Medal. When he returned to Philadelphia, he took advantage of his GI Bill benefits and signed up for lessons at the Greenough Music School in Center City, Philadelphia. The Greenough School, run by Ukrainian immigrant Isidore Greenough, was on the top floors of the Presser Building at 17th and Chestnut in Center City. I talked about Greenough on an earlier podcast about the music man Theodore Presser in Biographical Bites from Bala number 4. It was there that he met the mentor that so many of his biographers seem to have given short shrift, Dionigi Sandoli, who had Americanized his name to Dennis Sandoli. The legend is that after taking lessons from Sandola, Coltrane was never seen without a tenor saxophone in his hands. He would practice for hours on end, running scales, experimenting with rhythms, shattering time signatures, trying new chord progressions. He would often fall asleep with his horn still in his mouth. His neighbors on 33rd Street in North Philadelphia, where he purchased a house in 1952, recalled him playing into all hours of the night. And if someone complained about the noise, well, he simply stopped blowing into his horn, but continued fingering the keys on the sequences he was working on. He was silently running over the melody in his brain. His sound developed into something so unique, it actually had two nicknames. Initially came the Sheets of Sound, and then Coltrane Changes. Sheets of Sound was extremely dense, improvisational, yet patterned lines of high-speed arpeggios and scale patterns played in rapid succession, hundreds of notes running from the lowest to the highest registers. The lines are often faster than 16th notes. They consist of quintuplets, septuplets, etc., can sound like glissandos. Here's Train with pianist Thelonious Monk in 1957, a segment from a song called Trinkle Tinkle. John Coltrane on tenor sax with Thelonious Monk on piano. Monk's composition, Trinkle Tinkle. When John Batiste led the band on the late night television, it was Stephen Colbert. I guess he was Stephen Colbert's band leader. Whenever Colbert would crack a joke about the so-called P-tape with the Trump scandal, John Batiste would play the opening bars of Trinkle Tinkle over on his piano. Anyway, back to Coltrane. After two more years of practice and lessons from Sandole, his playing had reached another level of expertise when he released the classic Giant Steps in 1959. This was one of several albums released in 1959. Kind of Blue from Miles Davis, Mingus Ah-Um from Charles Mingus, Time Out from the Dave Brubeck Quartet, The Shape of Jazz to Come by Ornette Coleman. These threw down the gauntlet to the rest of the jazz world. This is the future. Follow us, boys. Now, with what became known as Coltrane Changes, more formally they're known as chromatic third relations and multitonic changes, John Coltrane pushed forward a harmonic progression variation that used substitute chords over common jazz progressions. Here is an early Coltrane example from another 1959 recording. This is Three Little Words, a standard tune recorded with vibraphonist Milt Jackson. Thank you. if those chord changes sound familiar, you can go all the way back to the 1937 classic, Have You Met Miss Jones, and hear exactly the same chord changes. I've got a treat for you. Here is the opening chorus sung by Tony Perkins.
Have you met Miss Jones? Someone said as we shook hands, she was just Miss Jones to me. Then I said, Miss Jones, you're a girl who understands. I'm a man who must be free. And all at once I lost my breath, and all at once was scared to death, and all at once I owned the earth.
Now, when I talk about Coltrane Changes, I have to talk about Giant Steps, a song which became a challenge for hundreds of jazz musicians. Giant Steps also became the inspiration of an education company that two friends and I started about 20 years ago, Giant Steps in Emergency Medicine. Here is an excerpt from Giant Steps by Coltrane, followed by a version of Paul Desmond's famous Take Five with, through the miracle and weirdness of artificial intelligence, a brief phrase played using Coltrane Changes. Beware, the Brubeck Desmond take is a little bit mind-bending. Coltrane's hunger for learning and absorption of music was all-consuming. It got to the point in jazz that most tenor sax players either sounded like John Coltrane or worked like crazy to avoid sounding like him. And there's no doubt that much of the scaffolding upon which Coltrane developed his playing style came from the South Philadelphia Italian-American guitar player and teacher Dennis Sandole. Dennis was born 29 September 1913 in Philadelphia. He was self-taught. He started playing the guitar sometime during his teens. He progressed quickly, and he went on to piano, theory, composition, and arranging. And eventually, he played in a group with his younger brother, Adolf. Adolf was a saxophonist who also became a teacher. Sandole started to perform in Atlantic City, New Jersey, where he played in the city's numerous nightclubs. The 5 July 1940 edition of the Press of Atlantic City lists under their vital statistics column, quote, Dennis Sandoln, that's S-A-N-D-O-L-N, 25, 2422 South 5th Street, Philadelphia, and Pauline Avrami, 19-3 Chelsea Terrace. Dennis was getting married. Pauline was apparently a quiet woman, a private woman. After she had two daughters and a son with Dennis, she left him sometime before 1955 because she remarried to New Jersey trumpet player John Albert Johnny D. DeFrancesco, who's no relation to Papa John and Joey DeFrancesco, as far as I can tell. Pauline is buried in New Jersey. Soon Dennis and his family moved to the West Coast, and he became a staff guitarist, composer, arranger, and jazz consultant for MGM Studios. That's where he worked with Billie Holiday and Frank Sinatra. And then he also played and recorded with many band leaders of the day. Granted, they were mostly second-rate band leaders, Ray McKinley, Boyd Rayburn, Charlie Barnett. He did some stuff with Tommy Dorsey, mostly on V-discs. I did find a recording of him doing a guitar solo with Charlie Barnett. This is his own composition called Dark Bayou. It was around this time that Dennis realized he wanted to be a teacher. He began work on pedagogical literature for jazz musicians and composers using his experience and close interaction with orchestral musicians to help shape his ability to eventually teach musical concepts to all types of instrumentalists. He wasn't just limited to guitar. When he returned to Philadelphia in the mid-1940s, he devoted the rest of his life to being a teacher. He performed and recorded only sporadically and is listed in Tom Lord's massive online jazz discography only twice after 1958, in the last 42 years of his life. As far as we know, he was only in the studio twice. John Coltrane became one of his weekly private students at the Granoff Studios for several years, and both men remained close for the rest of Train's life. Word spread about Sandole's abilities as a teacher, and he was sought for private lessons by many well-respected jazz musicians in Philadelphia, New York, and elsewhere. His skills as a performer, composer, and teacher were held in high regard by many influential modern jazz artists like Stan Kenton, Sonny Stitt, even Charlie Parker. Bird allegedly asked Sandole for a lesson. Sandole did not take beginners. One of his students said, quote, "Those studying with him already knew the mechanics and were seeking his insights on matters of concept, his knowledge of exotic scales, and other techniques to broaden an improviser's range of expression." He also wrote two pedagogical texts, which were reportedly finished by the time he returned to Philadelphia from the West Coast. These were the influential guitar method book, Guitar Lore, first published in 1976, and Scale Lore, an unpublished text consisting of some of Sandole's techniques for constructing unique scales, as well as material building with scalar and harmonic substitution in jazz composition and improvisation. Sandole's recorded output includes a collaboration with his brother Adolf of original compositions for jazz ensemble titled The Brothers Sandole, modern music from Philadelphia. It featured, among others, Art Farmer, Teo Macero, and Milt Hinton. And then there was the Dennis Sandole Project, a Sandole trilogy, a collection of material that featured him on guitar in a quartet setting from the 1950s, some solo piano and jazz combo combinations, and excerpts from what he termed his jazz ballet opera, Evenin' Is Cryin'. Other examples of Sandole as a composer include Wayward Pliant on James Moody's Running the Gamut, and Hyacinth on Art Farmer's The Many Faces of Art Farmer. If you are interested, I will play them both in their entirety at the end of the podcast. Other than Coltrane, Sandola's large roster of students included saxophonist James Moody, Benny Golson, Bobby Zankel, Billy Root, and Rob Brown, trumpeters Art Farmer and Randy Brecker, pianists Ron Thomas, Matthew Shipp, Sumi Tanuka, bagpipe player Rufus Harley. He said it was Sandole that convinced him to play jazz bagpipes. Basses Craig Thomas, Fred Weiss, and a very young Stanley Clark. Stanley was 20 when he recorded that solo for the introduction to Some Time Ago La Fiesta, an old Chick Corea album. He also trained guitarist Jim Hall, Billy Bean, John Collins, Dale Bruning, Joe DiOrio, Tom Giacobetti, and Pat Martino. This is another South Philadelphia native. Pat Martino was uncanny in his speed, his precision, and his ability to swing internally. You'll hear a lot of guitarists who are fast, like Paco de Lucia in flamenco, but they don't swing like the jazz players, and especially Pat Martino. Listen to him on this old Wes Montgomery song. Speaking of Dennis, Martino remarked, he taught us by not interfering with the blessings each student was giving, by amplifying them in any way that he could. A student under Dennis Sandola had a near full-time job, what with the practice. If you took the full course, one lesson per week, and you start with A1 and you go up to D24, and you did all of the exercises in the way that they were lined out, it would take you about 8 years to complete a course with Dennis Sandola. Coltrane took 2 lessons weekly, and he always, but always, showed up prepared. Sandola said, "Coltrane went through 8 years of my literature in 4 years. We became excellent friends. We had dinner together once a week." Dennis taught Coltrane pentatonic and modal scales, bitonality, polytonality, pedal point, cluster harmony, harmony derived from melodic lines, etc., etc. Although the last time the two men saw each other was 1963, Train kept in touch by phone and would often ask Dennis to send him more material to study. If you were a horn, piano, bass, or voice student, you had to perform each compositional device in every key. Guitar players were to play each device starting on every string and every finger while using the original untransposed device only, making octave adjustments as necessary. You learned to play the guitar. Every finger. He would start a phrase. He would have you play a phrase, and he'd start by having you play it starting with your index finger on the opening key, and then you would have to use your long finger, and then your ring finger, and then your small finger, and work through this device every time. Sandoli had continued his own lifelong attempt at guitar mastery through the study of traditional classical pedagogical texts like Niccolo Paganini's 24 Caprices for Solo Violin and Bach's 2- and 3-part Inventions and Sinfonias. And he also learned 20th century masters like Vincent Persichetti's 20th century harmonies. He was a walking encyclopedia of contemporary music. Now, I am not a musician. I'm most definitely not a musical theorist. And much of what I read about Dennis Sandola's teaching started to go way over my head. For instance, one of his former students wrote, quote, "The resultant scale used as a mirror image as the cadence misses the octave, C, D, E, F sharp, G, A, B, D flat. The result of joining 2 Scriabin, Lydian, tetrachords at the 5th degree, G, and so on." I have absolutely no idea what he's talking about. Absolutely none. Okay, by time, we're about halfway through the podcast. But I pretty much told you what I want to tell you about Dennis Sandole. I want to finish by reading you a large portion of a blog that was written by one of Sandole's pupils, Bert Miltenberger. He's a trumpeter. He took lessons from Dennis for a few years in the late 1990s, when Sandole was already in his 80s. This is the closest I have found to capturing what it must have been like to study with Dennis Sandole. Bart wrote this more than 13 years ago for his blog, Outside Pants. When I emailed him for permission to use his essay for a large part of the podcast, he was all for it. I have altered it very little. I consider myself to be pretty lucky. I took weekly lessons from Dennis Sandole for almost 3 years until he passed in September of 2000. I started studying music with the maestro, as his students often called him. To his face, I called him Mr. Sandole, in December of 1997. I had very good reason for doing so. My buddy saxophonist John Cole and I had been in a band together at the University of Pennsylvania. And then we joined another band together called Fathead right out of school. By the end of 1997, Fathead had been doing plenty of touring, and my trumpet chops were getting worse and worse. I was never that serious about pursuing music, and though I played throughout college, I rarely ever practiced. I was an English major. In between tours, John had started taking lessons with Sandole, and after only a month and a half, he was already sounding better, and he was playing some more interesting things in his solos. And meanwhile, I was getting worse. My ego couldn't handle that, so I asked John for Mr. Sandola's number. I called him and set up an audition. It was a good move for me, and the next few years of study really impacted my life in a positive way. I remember being nervous walking to the Maestro's 1622 Spruce Street studio that first time. I mean, this was the guy that taught Coltrane, after all, and a bunch of other jazz giants, many of whom I didn't know about at the time. When I went inside, I realized the studio was really just a big downstairs living room in an old but really nice Philly row home. Tall ceilings, wood doors, wood molding around the windows and the walls. The carpet was a brownish color. Everything was kind of brown in there, including the grand piano and the Maestro's chair. In fact, Mr. Sandola was wearing a tan sports coat over a brown sweater and khaki pants. Even his hair, which I'm sure would have been white, had been dyed brown. I introduced myself, sat down, and was asked a bit about myself and what I wanted to learn. I don't remember how I replied. I do remember that I was then asked to play something. I think I just made something up on the spot. It probably wasn't very good. Mr. Sandole asked me a few more questions. Who was your trumpet teacher? Frank Eisenreich in Pittsburgh. Well, Frank Eisenreich gave you a very nice tone on the trumpet. Did he teach you any piano or theory? No, not really. Well, he should have. We'll work on that. I guess I'd been accepted. Then Mr. Sandole told me about how his lessons were going to be structured and how I would need several music manuscript books, one for him, the others for me. And he also told me about payment for the lessons. It was $50 a lesson. You had to take a lesson every week, no skipping or taking once a month. Consistency was the only way toward improvement. And the money was never to be discussed again. When my lesson was over, I was to place the money or the check on the right side of the piano keyboard. It was my responsibility to make sure that I placed the money there. If I was short 1 week, I'd make it up the next. Do you understand? Yes. Then we don't need to discuss this again. And he wrote my first lesson for me. A cool thing about studying with Dennis Sandoli. The lessons he wrote for me were just for me. They had never been written before, and they were written specifically for me, geared toward my needs and weaknesses. I can't speak about other students' lesson material because everyone received personalized material that was created specifically for them and their needs. Now, that said, from what I can gather from other students, there were some structural things that most students' lessons shared. Lessons were built on a 4-week cycle, and the breakdown was often similar. Here's how mine were built. And again, the elements of the Maestro's literature, that's what he called it, so that's what I call it, that I received were different from what other students received. Many, probably most other students, were more advanced than me. So what they studied was probably heavier than what I had. Stick with me, Bart, and I will take you to the heights of virtuosity. Week 1, chord progression, arpeggio, piano voicings. The chord progression, called A1, was always written in 3/4 time. At least for me it was. I still don't know why. If any former students have an explanation for this, I'd sure love to hear it. And my progression was usually 4 or 5 bars long with 1 chord per beat. The maestro would write a line that went with the chord progression. And a lot of the times, there would be a weird scale at the end of this progression, maybe some strange altered scale that, honestly, to my ears, usually sounded like an extension of the weird melody line that went with the 4 or 5 bar chord progression. My job was to memorize this 4 or 5 bar melody and transpose it into the other 11 keys. I've never been very good at memorizing, and I think I got freaked out at the idea of having to memorize all of this music every week. So I wrote out my exercises in all 12 keys. To get the most out of the material, I should have memorized it. Sandole told me that Coltrane memorized his lessons in all 12 keys. Remember, he took 2 lessons a week, 8 years worth of literature in 4 years. Bobby Zankel told me that he memorized his. Anyway, just playing through those melodies in all keys was a real workout on the chops, but more importantly on the ear. I had never heard anything like those melodies before. They were so strange and weird to me, and thus challenging to play. Next up, A2. It was an arpeggio that the maestro gave me. Memorize it. Play it in all keys. This I could do. I didn't play them fast, but I could play them without mistakes. Subsequent week ones would have me playing an inversion of the original arpeggio, again in all keys. This cycle continued every week one until I exhausted those notes and started a new arpeggio. Week one, for me, also included some work on the piano. Don't neglect the piano, the maestro told me. Sorry, maestro, I still neglect the piano. And it shows. My piano material was originally just basic voicings, either for specific chords or for the A1 progression itself. But as time went on, the voicings got more and more advanced. So that was week one. Week two, substitute chords, ear training, and rhythm studies. Week two's lesson began with substitute chords, B1, but after a while that morphed into turnbacks. The same idea from A1 applies, a 4 or 5 bar melody line, but this time the chords in the 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th bar were all substitute chords for the 1st bar's chord. The whole line and progression had to be played in all 12 keys. When I practiced B1, I would just look at the melody line as one big long line, and I would look at the chord subs as something else entirely. Maybe that wasn't the correct way to approach it, but that's what I did. Next came ear training, B2, and for me that usually involved singing scales and their inversions in subsequent B2s using solfège, do, re, mi, etc. No, dulce. Solfège, by the way, is a musical education method to teach oral skills, pitch, and sight reading of Western music. It depends on that familiar do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti scale that you've known since you were a little kid. Then came rhythm studies, B3, which I really enjoyed. I worked out of the maestro's list of Latin rhythms. The assignment was to compose a 4 or 5 bar theme using his rhythms and combining 8 consecutive notes moving forward or backward from any of the melody lines in A1, B1, or C1. Ultimately, the longer I studied, the more literature I accrued, and this exercise almost gave me the freedom to write whatever I wanted, still within the construct of the rhythm studies. I also used to apply this exercise to the chord progressions from A1. Over the years, some of these little B3 melodies have turned into full-length tunes. Week 3, tritone principles, sight singing, compose paraphrase on C1. Week 3 started with C1, which for me initially was based on Sandoli's tritone principle. C1, again, was similar to A1 and B1, in that I was given a melody line that went along with a chord progression. The difference here was there was one chord per beat, again, in three-quarter time. In bar 1, the first chord, beat 1, could be a G7. And the third chord, beat 3, would be D-flat 7, the tritone sub. The second chord, beat 2, would be a passing chord to get to the tritone. In this case, it might be an A-flat minor 7th. Again, the whole line and progression had to be played in all 12 keys. And just like B1, when I practiced C1, I would just look at the melody line as one big long line, and I would look at the chords as something else entirely. C2 was sight-seeing for me, usually out of the Melodia book. I never made it to Modus Novus like some students. I would have specific pages assigned to me, and I had to sing the line with movable do, fixed do, and with just a sound, no solfege syllable, like DDD. C3 was a fun assignment. Take the melody line from that week's C1, write out the notes, not the rhythms, in order, the theme. Write it out in retrograde, backwards, then superimpose one on top of the other, diametrically opposed. When I did this, I wrote the theme in blue ink and the retrograde in red. Together, they look pretty cool. Sometimes I use the whole entire 4 or 5 bar line. Sometimes I split it up into 1 bar at a time segments. Then the idea was to compose melodies based on these blue-red diametrically opposed notes. Again, using 8 notes in a row, going left or right, either red or blue, or a combination of blue and red. And if I wanted, I could use the rhythms from his list of rhythms, or I could use whatever rhythms I wanted. I usually try to get these melodies to go along with some kind of chord progression. This was a fun exercise. I should also mention at this point that anywhere during weeks 1, 2, or 3, I could be given some of the maestro's scales. Some were what he called exotic scales. And as time went on, I started getting some of his own synthetic scales, which I assume were built on his combining 2 existing scales to create a new scale. These scales were supplements to my regular workload. He encouraged me to play them, of course, in all keys. I could also use them for the assignment in week 4. Week 4, composition. Week 4, D1, D2, and D3 was my favorite week in the 4-week cycle. I really look forward to it. The D1 assignment was to pick a song, a standard. Once the maestro found out that I listened to a lot of the blues, he would encourage me to pick Mingus or Monk tunes. I was to take the chords from just the first 8 bars of the tune. Don't go past the 8 bars, or that will diminish the quality of your work. And if I felt like it, I could reharmonize the progression using his chord substitutions from B1. This would often create a totally different sounding progression. And then I had to compose a theme to go with this new progression. I had to use 8 consecutive notes from his literature, A1, B1, C1, scales, etc. I could use the notes going forward or backward. And here's the kicker. I could use his notes, or if I felt like it, and I often did, I could sharp or flat any of his notes. I could also give each note whatever duration I wanted, and I could use whatever time signature I wanted. Essentially, I could write whatever the hell I wanted, but I still had to work within his constructs. Oftentimes, the lines would sound like me, but sometimes the shapes of the lines were his. I also had to write lyrics or poetry to go along with my theme and progression. I used to think that I was writing some good poetry for these D1s, but the maestro never seemed too impressed. I usually got lazy with D2. Shame on me. I missed out. The D2 assignment was to take my new 8-bar chord progression from D1 and write chord voicings for it. Mine were usually pretty lame, and it showed when I had to hop on the piano and play them at my lessons. D3 was kind of like D1, compose an improvisation that accompanies the theme, melody, and progression I had just written, and I had to use the same rules from D1. Week 4 was a lot of fun. I really put a lot of time writing these exercises, and a lot of these melodies ended up becoming full-length tunes or the basis of tunes. Whenever I'm writing or I hit a wall, I can always use the Maestro's literature and mix it up in this way to create something totally new and totally mine. At least that's the goal. As I went on, my A's, B's, and C's changed a bit. I received gradually more and more complex literature. The weird lines would start to get groupings of fives and sevens because Sandole sensed that I needed that. The chord progressions would start to sound stranger and stranger, and my ears opened up wider and wider. To be honest, a lot of this material was, and probably still is, over my head theoretically. But I knew that there was something there for me, and I knew that Mr. Sandole would not be around forever. I had to get some of that literature before the opportunity was gone. I should also say that I really liked Mr. Sandole. He made me feel special, like I had something to offer. But he wouldn't really compliment me or blow smoke up my ass. Sometimes he didn't really mention anything about what I had just played for him at all. He would maybe just smile or nod or say, "Good," and then write out the next week's lesson. And if I was ill-prepared, he might barely say anything to me, leaving me feeling really low and determined to not repeat that performance the next week. We also would have great conversations about music and musicians. He told me he was a big fan of Jimi Hendrix's. And also personal things. He had a warm smile and a subtle sense of humor. He met my girlfriend, who's now my wife, and I swear he flirted with her. When I told him a couple years later that my wife and I were going to have a baby, he was so excited with the biggest smile I ever saw on his face. He told me how happy he was for me. I remember feeling like one of the special students when he asked me a few times to go around the corner to the deli on 17th Street to get him a sandwich and some juice. Not everybody got that job. I can still hear his voice in my head. I asked him once if he ever smoked. I was sure that he had. He told me that when he was young, he had smoked for about 10 days, but he quit. "You see, Bart, when I was a young man, I was very vain, and I didn't like the way the cigarette stained my fingers. And when I saw that, I quit smoking." The last few lessons I took were at Mr. Sandola's apartment in Roxborough. His health was declining, and getting to town and back was getting to be too much. The last lesson I received was twice as long as anything I had ever been given before. It was the hardest A1 I had ever played. I think I had one of his final lessons. I believe Dennis Sandole was a genius. That's not something you find every day. Okay, thanks again to trumpeter Bart Miltenberger for allowing me to reproduce that last segment from his blog, Outside Pants. Dennis Sandole of Pine Street in South Philadelphia is undeniably one of the masters of modern jazz, even though he performed little and recorded even less. If you go to YouTube, you're going to find the two albums he made with his brother, Modern Music from Philadelphia, Brothers Sandole, and the other, which was more or less a collection of things that he'd been recording through the years. Even more impressive, you're going to find many of his friends and former students giving testimonials, high praise in interviews, Sunny Tanuka especially. Dennis Sandole died of congestive heart failure at his home in Roxborough on the last day of September in 2000. It was the day after his 87th birthday. There was no mention of a spouse in his obituary, which said he was survived by three children, three grandchildren, and two great-grandchildren. In retrospect, Dennis Sandola's fingerprint has been all over jazz for the last 70 years, yet few people know his name. I have read three biographies and numerous magazine articles and book chapters about John Coltrane, and I was vaguely aware of Dennis Sandola was his teacher in Philadelphia. I had no idea what that influence was and how deeply it sinks into the body of contemporary jazz itself. Now, every time you hear a chord that's new to you, or you marvel at an acrobatic run on a guitar or a piano or a trumpet, or you listen yet one more time to that perpetual motion machine that is Giant Steps, put in a thanks to Dennis Sandola. The June 2024 episode of All Bones Considered, Laurel Hill Stories number 63, is about three early 19th century Philadelphia playwrights. Richard Penn Smith, who created the legend of Davy Crockett that we remember today. Robert Montgomery Bird, whose play The Gladiator became one of the best-known pieces in Edwin Forrest's repertoire. And George Henry Boker, a Princeton graduate, whose best-known play is Francesca da Rimini. In Biographical Bites from Bala, Laurel Hill West Stories, episode number 33 from mid-June, I will talk about Laurel Hill West's sweet tooth. I already told you about the Bassetts and the Briars and the ice cream connections, but there's the Wilbur family, a famed Wilbur Buds, who are buried there, as his Franklin Baker, who got into the imported coconut business by accident. And he turned it into a very successful career. That's right, Baker's Coconut is not just for bakers. It was invented by Franklin Baker. For current activities at the cemetery, go to the website, laurelhillphl.com/events. I have two tours coming up. I've got one this Saturday at Laurel Hill West. It is a long walk around the periphery to visit lots of sportsmen, including the members of several halls of fame. We have members of the Hall of Fame for baseball, tennis, golf, college football, hockey, skiing. Come on the tour and learn about these people and their fascinating stories. I'm also giving a standard Sacred Spaces and Storied Places tour. If you would like an introductory tour to Laurel Hill West, that would be the one to go on. All Bones Considered and Biographical Bites from Bala are mostly researched, written, narrated, and produced by me, Joe Lex, retired professor of emergency medicine from Temple University, volunteer tour guide, and podcaster for both cemeteries. You can reach me through my email, jrlexjr1947@gmail.com. The theme song, Names at Peace, is by local artist James Harrow. And maybe I will see you on a tour. Stay safe, stay well. The bibliography follows, as do two songs written by Dennis Sandole. I'm going to put them at the end for you after the bibliography. That's Art Farmer's Hyacinth and James Moody's Wayward Plaint. Okay, bibliography. Two large essays by two scholars of the music, or two scholars of music, and I appreciate both of them so much. Thomas Scott McGill's essay, Dennis Sandoli's Unique Jazz Pedagogy, that has an opening quote from Benny Goldsmith, said Dennis was an intellectual. Dennis had something special going. This was online. It is in a PDF format. It is 45 pages long. It is incredibly detailed. If you can't find it online, email me and I'll send you a copy. And then the other And the other was from a blog by trumpeter Bart Miltenberger. His blog is Outside Pants. And this is an old blog. He wrote this 13 years ago, but he was very happy to share it with me. And I'm glad that he did, because that was essentially what the last half of the podcast was. Then also by T. Scott McGill, we've got Arnold Schoenberg, Dennis Sandola, and John Coltrane, Important Links in Modern Jazz Pedagogy and Practice. And this is another PDF I got online. Where is the reference on this? I don't see the reference. This is Thomas McGill is in United Kingdom. He wrote this in 2014. He revised it in 2016. This is 40 pages long, so there's a lot of good dense material here also. Again, if you can't find it online, if you're interested in this, it's called Arnold Schoenberg, Dennis Sandoli, and John Coltrane, Important Links in Modern Jazz Pedagogy and Practice by T. Scott McGill. If you can't find this online, email me, jrlexjr1947@gmail.com, and I will gladly send you a copy. Then there's Expanding Jazz Tonality, the Compositions of John Coltrane, that was written by Henry Martin. It is from Theory and Practice, which is published by the Music Theory Society of New York State. This is from Volume 3738, 2012-2013, pages 185-219. John Coltrane's Pursuit of Elegance by Aaron Yale Heisler. This is from the African American Review, Winter 2015, Volume 48, Number 4, pages 393-413. Coltrane plays the blues, Multi-Level Coherence and Stylistic Tendencies by Lucas Gebrick. This is a dissertation that was written in September of 2020. It is for City University of New York, a dissertation submitted to the graduate faculty in music in partial fulfillment of the requirements for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, the City University of New York, 2020. And finally, Aural, that's A-U-R-A-L, Archetypes and Cyclic Perspectives in the Work of John Coltrane and Ancient Chinese Music Theory. The author is Hafez Modirzadeh, that's M-O-D-I-R-Z-A-D-E-H, Black Music Research Journal, Spring 2001, Volume 21, Number 1, pages 75-106. Lots of good stuff this month in the reference material. If you are a jazz scholar and you can't find these articles, just email me. I will gladly share them with you. Okay, I thank you for listening, and I hope to see you around the cemetery. Stay safe, stay well. Two Dennis Sandola songs coming up next.